What is causing the obesity epidemic? This is the million-dollar question. And the standard answer is, well, we eat too much and move too little. And when it comes to what people are eating too much of, there are two camps. The medical establishment tend to pick on fat, while the alternative health camps, of which I'm a card-carrying member, tend to pick on carbs, particularly refined carbs. But what if we're not seeing the wood for the trees? That is, we are so involved in the details of something that we're missing what is important about the thing as a whole. Maybe it's time to look at the big picture. This is what a group of Chinese researchers have done, and it makes for some very interesting reading. Join us for this episode of Better Body Chemistry TV as we take a 10,000-foot view of the obesity epidemic to explore possible solutions. Better Body Chemistry TV is brought to you by Dr. Sandy, a scientist-turned-gremlin buster, helping you battle sugar gremlins, heifer lumps, and other health horribles through better body chemistry. Remember, small things can make a big difference to your health. Now, the Chinese team kicked off their analysis by looking at what everyone in the USA was eating instead of looking at individuals. They also looked at how fat the average American was. Now, the official name for this type of study is it's an ecological study. Scientifically, it's not the best kind of study to do because, well, Mr. Average is a bit of a mythical character. Despite these limitations, ecological studies can point out interesting relationships, which is exactly what this study did. First up, the team looked at the average saturated fat consumption, using meat as a proxy. The little green triangles show how much meat the average American is eating, and the blue dots how fat the average American is. Now, meat consumption has gone down significantly. You can see this by the fact that the green line has gotten progressively lower. The graph shows that the anti-fat campaign has changed the way people eat. But sadly, obesity, the blue line, has gone up. Next, the team looked at the consumption of sugar. Sugar consumption is depicted by the little black stars, and it certainly has increased, but not really in proportion to obesity. So once more, this doesn't really look like it explains the phenomenon well. This leaves us with the last set of graphs, which documents the consumption of grains by the average American. The white circles represent grain consumption and the blue dots obesity. This graph is really weird. It seems to be telling two stories. The first thing it shows is actually a long time ago, people ate a lot more grains than they do today. The amount of grain people ate decreased until the 1970s, and then it started to climb. Now, this increase corresponded with the anti-fat message, which was encouraging people to switch from meat to grains. The funny thing is that the climb in grain consumption starting in the 1970s also corresponded with a climb in obesity. So if we were to believe this graph, it would suggest that grains are actually what is causing the obesity problem. But grains were not always causing obesity. Something happened to create the problem. If we take a look at the obesity timeline, the obesity epidemic in America really kicks off in the 1980s. The number of fat Americans continued to tick upward, but it appears to have reached a plateau in the last few years. The rest of the world has joined the party, so today the problem is not restricted to the developed world, but is a global phenomenon affecting both developed and developing countries. So the question is, well, what happened in the 1970s? Well, there were sex, drugs, rock and roll, and the Green Revolution. Agriculturally speaking, the 1970s saw big advances in agriculture, improving productivity. New improved variants of maize and other crops were grown along with chemical fertilizers. This time period is known as the Green Revolution and was spearheaded by American scientists. but the uptake of the technology was pretty much universal. The only exception to this was the continent of Africa as a whole, which to date still hasn't quite managed to catch up. This is one of the reasons there's so much hunger in Africa. But another innovation also happened to grains during this time period. In 1974, to be precise, authorities in the USA began adding extra vitamins to the flour. Now, the motivation was to stop vitamin B deficiency, which caused a very nasty disease called pellagra. The vitamins that were added from the vitamin B family included thiamine, riboflavin, and niacin. So, is there a connection between these vitamins and obesity? Well, other countries followed the American example and also added extra vitamins to their grains. Obesity problems seemed to track with vitamin B fortification programs. Countries that did it got fatter, whereas countries that didn't appeared to buck the trend. So which vitamin is causing the problem? Well, three vitamins were used in the original fortification programs. Thiamine and riboflavin seem to be innocent bystanders in the story. The only one that has got a few black marks against it is niacin. And if we look at the graphs in the Chinese study, we find that the amount of niacin the average American consumes, that would be the white dots, sort of follows those obesity dots, the blue ones. Freaky? But it could be coincidence. However, there are a few things that add weight to the argument. Now, niacin is made into NAD+ and NADP+. These act as cofactors, helping to power a whole bunch of enzymes, particularly enzymes involved in producing energy in the body. NAD regulates energy metabolism. It also plays an important role in DNA damage repair and gene expression. It's involved in the process of deacetylation. So, niacin, the vitamin, is definitely a keeper. It's so useful that niacin at high doses is used as a prescription medication to treat patients battling to keep their cholesterol in check. The way that it does this, it increases the levels of the good cholesterol. Now, this sounds good. So, where is the black mark? Well, it turns out niacin can lead to diabetes. It doesn't happen to everyone, but for many people, high doses of niacin cause them to develop glucose intolerance. The root of this problem is insulin resistance. Being insulin resistant is a big contributor to acquiring that spare tire because your body chemistry is stuck storing fat instead of burning fat. Today, niacin is pretty much everywhere. Mother Nature puts it in animal protein, like meat, poultry, and fish. Governments put it in staples such as flour, maize meal, and rice. Thoughtful food company executives chuck it into processed foods to improve the nutritional quality and encourage you to buy their brand. And you also find a hefty dose in your multivitamin. Officially, you need 14 to 16 milligrams. The average American is getting 33 milligrams. You might be getting 5 times this amount. Now, chemicals are interesting things. There's a dose that is perfect. Too little, and you may have issues. But too much is also a potential problem. And of course, the perfect dose will depend on you. So, maybe taking that multivitamin supplement loaded with 138% of the RDA of vitamin B3, along with vitamin-enriched cereal providing 20% of the RDA, drowned in vitamin-enriched milk, along with cold chicken slices containing natural niacin, squished between 2 slices of bread baked with vitamin-enriched flour, is resulting in a bit too much of this good thing. You want less niacin, not more. Now, cutting back is probably going to be a bit tough, since, as I said, it is everywhere. But having said that, you don't purposefully need to take more. And don't fall for the marketing hype and deliberately buy products to which it has been added, believing that you are getting extra value for your money. you may be buying extra kilograms around your middle. The final strategy to consume less is to steer clear of processed foods, especially things that are made with wheat flour and maize meal. This will help you to create better body chemistry and better health. Interested in discovering more ways to create better body chemistry or need a little help getting your body chemistry on track? Visit our website at www.betterbodychemistry.com. Browse our library or enroll in one of our courses or programs. The advice is simple to follow and based on real science, not hype. Know someone who is obsessed about getting enough vitamin B? Share this video with them so that they realize, as with most chemicals, there is a sweet spot. Yes, too little is a problem, but so is too much. If you enjoyed this video, be sure to subscribe to our channel so you catch future episodes of Better Body Chemistry TV. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you next time. Remember, small things can make a big difference to your health.